morning to all you people in the front. We got one. Good morning to all the people in the middle. They are not anywhere to be awake. Good morning to all the people in the back. They got here early. They are rowdy. That's how they got those seats. Good morning to all you people in the lobby. We're going to start without you, but come on in. You might hear something you want to know about. And the first thing we're going to talk about is Miss Lisa Creasy. Is Lisa in here? Where's Miss Lisa? Is she in here yet? She's out there in the lobby selling this thing probably. But she is going to lead a Bible study coming up, a precept study of the book of Ephesians. And it is down to the wire. You have 1 week left to sign up for this. 1 week. Next Sunday is the deadline to sign up. Miss Lisa is so just inviting for all of us that she put her personal phone number and email right in this church bulletin. You can email her, you can call her, send her a text, or sign up in the lobby and let her know that you're going to come. You'll see the cost, you'll see the times. There are two sessions, a morning session and an evening session, so you should have no excuse. Come be a part of that precept study of the book of Ephesians. Next Sunday, the 14th, is the deadline to sign up. The class starts at the end of the month. Canoe trip, August 20th. The weather is perfect. We've had some rain lately. The water level will be perfect. Sign up for a canoe trip. You're going to see in the bulletin, you can get a canoe, you can get a kayak, you can bring your own boat. There are different costs for all of those, address, all this kind of stuff. Canoe trip, August 20th. Any age, come on out. Brother Matt can even do it, so you should feel comfortable that you can do it. No problems at all. Also on August 20th, we are having Operation Clean Sweep. So that is where we're going to clean the children's hallway, the preschool hallway, and that is for all of our programming. We have children's programming 4 days a week, Sunday nights, Wednesday nights, and Kingdom Kids 2 days a week. That's with nothing special. Our children are in the building 4 nights a week, so we need you to come help, clean stuff, get stuff ready for their fall programming. That is also on August 20th. You'll see the times in there, 9 a.m. to noon. But what that means is all of you should have something to do on August 20th. You can come clean the preschool hallway. You can come float down the Harpeth River. But everyone should have something to do August 20th right here to help the church body. Nothing. Nobody, they're like, I don't know. I can't commit to either one of those right now. August 20th, come help us out. Big thing right here. You can invite someone to come clean. You can invite somebody to ride a canoe with you. But you can for sure invite somebody to fall kickoff and game night. This is going to be a lot of fun right here. August 28th, 5 p.m. is when it gets started. Food trucks, multiple food trucks. Which food trucks are going to be here? I'm not going to spoil the surprise. You got to show up to find out. Multiple food trucks. We're going to play games. We're going to have a kickoff for all the fall programming. Bring your musical knowledge with you. We are going to play Parkway's version of Name That Tune. Name That Tune. So bring your appetite and also bring a little competitive spirit. And we need some people to volunteer for that. So don't be nervous. Come on up. Name That Tune. We will only make fun of you the rest of that night. All right? After that night's over, we will stop making fun of you. Unless I cannot think of something for announcements, I will definitely make fun of you then as well. All right? That is coming up August 28th. So make sure you make plans for that. That is a Sunday night. That will be a great time for all of us. And speaking of all of us, we are glad that all of us are here this morning. We're glad you're here in person. We're glad you're online if you're with us on Facebook. So happy that you are here today. We hope that in a few minutes you greet someone that you know and greet someone that you don't know. All right? If you see a stranger to you, go shake their hands, tell them your name. You're not strangers anymore. We all love new friends. So make a new friend today. But now we're going to turn our attention to the baptistry as we are making a new friend for eternity. Mr. Allen.
Well, good morning. It is super weird waiting on that to come up. I just have to tell y'all. Y'all are like, there's Mr. Allen. Yeah, I'm here. Hey, it is so good to see you guys this morning. It is a great day to be in the house of the Lord. I'm always thankful to be here together as Parkway family, but it is even greater when we have a great reason to celebrate. Now, side note, I just enjoy being able to wear my swim trunks at church with my chacos. But that actually is a great thing because it means that we're doing a baptism this morning. And I am so excited to be able to present Miss Caitlin Pemberton to you. And so we want to present her. Come on down, Miss Caitlin. You got it, girl? There you go. All right. Let's go over here. That's pretty good. All right. Stand up. I tell you what, stand on this one right over here. You want to do that? There we go. I think y'all can see Miss Caitlin. It is my joy to present to you Miss Caitlin Pemberton. Now, Caitlin's coming this morning, and this is a little different, okay? But it's going to work, I promise. Miss Caitlin comes to join with us here at Parkway. She actually accepted Christ back at Vacation Bible School, but her family lives a little further away, but they come here, and they wanted this to be their home church. So we want to present her to the church, and y'all give her that Parkway wave of welcome. Now, Caitlin, that is just to say we're with you, okay? We're investing in you, and you're going to invest in us, and it's a beautiful thing that God gives us called community, and we're so thankful. So we're excited about what God's done in you. And then we also, because she's not here all the time, we're also going to baptize her this morning so that she can go ahead and have that testimony to the rest of the world that she has trusted Jesus as her Lord and Savior. Again, God's been working on Caitlin for a long time, and it was during Vacation Bible School this past year that she said, you know what, I need Jesus to be my Savior. So she talked with Miss Melody, she talked with her grandmother, Sasha, I always say it wrong, forgive me, Pembertons, but she's been making that clear, and she knows today that she is putting her faith and her trust in Jesus. So, Miss Caitlin, we're going to baptize you now. Remember what we said we're going to do? We're going to put our hand down here, we're going to grab right here. Okay, cool. That'll work. We're going to turn this way. All right. Caitlin, have you trusted Jesus to be your Lord and Savior? Mm-hmm. You have. That's so awesome, girl. Listen, because you have professed that, it is now my privilege to baptize you as my sister in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Okay, so grab your nose. Okay. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death and raised to walk in newness of life. Y'all go ahead. You hear that? All right. That is a great, great thing. Now you can go ahead, Doctor. We're going to pray for Miss Caitlin, and then we're going to stand and greet one another. So let's pray together. Father, you are amazing. Thank you for this wonderful day that you have given us. I thank you for Caitlin. Lord, I thank you for her sweet and gentle spirit and just for the family that she's a part of and now the greater family that she's a part of, being a part of our church family. Lord, I thank you most of all that she's yours. Lord, continue to grow her up in you. Help her to stand for you and live for you in all the days of her life. Lord, I thank you for this time that we have to worship you. Lord, let us worship you today in spirit and in truth. For those that need encouragement, let them be encouraged. For those who need truth, let them hear it. For those who need to be reminded, let them be reminded. But most of all, Lord, may your name be glorified in this place. Father, we love you, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If y'all would, stand and greet one another. Let somebody know you're glad they're here this morning. Give them a hug or a handshake or a pat on the back. It'll be great.
Good morning, Parkway Church. Let's get our hands together and celebrate. It's time to be glad this morning. Give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever. Give praise to the Lord. Beside him there's no other. Sing it again. Give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever. Oh, yeah. Give praise to the Lord. Beside Him there's no other. We sing this morning. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He brought us from mourning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. So what are we waiting for? Oh, la, 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. Oh, la, 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 la. Hear the word of the Lord. There's freedom for the captives. Oh, yeah. Oh, good news to the poor. Beauty for the ashes. So what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He brought us from mourning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. So what are we waiting for? Oh, la, 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. Oh, la, 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 la. What are we waiting for? Oh, la, 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. I live to tell what the Lord has done. I live to sing of my Savior's love. I live because He is risen. Oh, la, 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 la. We sing it again. I live to tell what the Lord has done. I live to sing of my Savior's love. This is the day the Lord has made. Come on. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. Hey. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He promised from morning to dancing, from glory to glory, from morning to dancing, from glory to glory, from morning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. What are we waiting for? Oh, la, 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. Oh, la, 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 la. What are we praising the Lord? La, 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Amen, church.
Joy is mine.
whose resurrection means I'll rise. There isn't time enough to sing of all you've done, but I have eternity to try. Church, I don't know what you've been facing this week. You've had a stressful week. You've had a great week. But I love Lamentations 3, 23, 24 that says, great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance, therefore I will hope in him. So no matter what you're facing, church, we can find hope and our faithful God, because even when our faith is small, we can still rely on our faithful God who will never let you down. And when so we sing how great his faithfulness is to us this morning. So church, let's give him all the glory. Let's give him respect that he's due this morning and sing to him this morning.
faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Jesus, we thank you for your faithfulness, for always being with us. Jesus, we are here for you this morning. And as we sing praises to you, God, and we honor how great you are, let us pray that we continue to have an open eye and an open heart this morning. And you receive the message. Receive the message this morning from you, God. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Thank you for worshiping. You can go ahead and be seated at this time again.
Well, good morning, Parkway. Try it again. Good morning. That's great. Great. I want a question for you. Those of you who are joining us in online, thank you for joining with us. Those of you who are in the house, question for all of you. What's your joy level like today? I know something happened this week, and I know you were disappointed and you were frustrated, but what's your joy level? 10 is a outstanding, highest it's ever been. 1 is, what is joy? Somewhere between the two. I'm not going to ask you to confess it. Just get that number in your mind today. What is your joy level today? And why isn't it higher? What is it that's keeping your joy from being higher than it really is? Because, you know, 2 weeks ago on a Sunday, we were talking about joy, and I said these words. I said, you know, for some of you out there, life is going to happen this week, and it's going to be hard to find joy. And the very next day, somebody was in the hospital, emergency surgery. The next day, someone else found out they had brain cancer and was having surgery 2 days later. Life happened to Parkway in a big way the next day. Last week, I said, wow, that couldn't happen again, could it? I mean, what are the chances of that, right? But I said, you know, chances are, though, that some of us, we're going to be in this room last Sunday, and we're going to hear a challenge about having joy in all circumstances, and then life is going to happen to somebody this next week. And the very next morning, life happened to some Parkway people back in the hospital again. More emergency surgery, watching loved ones struggle and almost on death's door, and watch God walk through them through that situation over the next 2 or 3 days with us praying and watching them go through trying to find joy in the midst of difficult days. And so I had a couple of weeks where I was in the hospitals a lot. The guy who checks you in recognized me and said, I know you. You're just going in. That's fine. That's fine. You're just going in. Good to see you again, Pastor. So we were in the hospitals a lot the last couple of weeks, walking together, doing life together as the Parkway family, because that's what family does, right? We're there for each other. So I had this idea that maybe by later in the week, you know, I can kind of take a break, because I've already done funerals, and we've met and talked about other funerals, and we prayed over people. We've walked and done life together with people in the hospital. So I thought, maybe this week, maybe I'll actually get an off day. And I planned for Thursday morning. I'm gonna do a little golf. Maybe that will recharge my battery. I don't know. Sometimes that frustrates me even more. Maybe that steals my joy more than anything else. You know, bad golf is painful. But, you know, it's better than a day's work is what they say, right? So I was going to, thank you, Jim Norton, yeah. So Thursday morning, I was going to go and play some golf. And then life happened at the Megginson house. Wednesday night, Heather's like, we're in the bed, and she said, do I hear water running upstairs? And we discovered that the upstairs bathroom was leaking. And so Thursday morning, this is what our laundry room looked like by Thursday morning, right? This is our house, right? Water has been coming down for a couple of days, and we're like, I don't know what to do about that. And so I decided that I was just going to investigate. I need to figure out where this water's coming from. And Heather's like, aren't you going to call somebody? And I'm like, well, yeah, eventually, but I would like to know. I could do some preliminary work, right? So I decide I'm going to get up, and I start tearing out drywall as if I know what I'm doing, right? There is the drywall, right? And I discover that, sure enough, there's a leak coming from upstairs, and it is beyond my pay grade. And sometimes when life happens, you just kind of throw up your hands and kind of go, oh, well, and here's me just like, wait. what am I going to do? And Heather's like, you're not going to fix it, are you? And I was like, no, I'm not going to try to fix that. I don't want to cut up into the floor, and I'm going to hit electrical, and I'm going to be in the emergency room, and other people are going to have to come visit me. And no, I'm not going to do that. So this is what was going on in our house. Plumbers coming, drywall gone, and we're going to have to try to get all of that fixed. And you know what? Sometimes that would have just really stressed me out. But the second that we heard water and I pulled that drywall down and water came just gushing down where it had been sitting up there for hours, my first thought was, Philippians, have joy. Because we've been going through this for 6 weeks. Maybe if it was week one, I wouldn't have got it. But 6 weeks in, that is the first thing I thought of. Oh, I'm supposed to have joy in the midst of this circumstance. And I have to tell you, it made a difference in how I responded. I was not stressed out. I wasn't thinking about how much is this going to cost, but now that I said it out loud, now I'm starting to get a little stressed out, right? But I was approaching it differently than I've ever approached it before. Why? Because I am being intentional about finding joy. How about you? Is this what your life looked like this week? Last Sunday, it was great, and something happened in the midst of this week, and all of a sudden, you find yourself doing life, frustrated, alone, isolated, struggling, and you can't find the joy in the midst of it. What's your joy level this week? What is it that's keeping you from having the joy that Paul asked us to have for the first three chapters of Philippians? And now we're in chapter four, and for some of us, myself included, we struggle sometimes because life is hard. And we find ourselves looking at the circumstances around us, and we're letting that steal our joy. And Paul is trying to talk to the Philippians, and he's trying to talk to them about when life happens, because it will happen. You know that, right? There's no promise for believers that we're protected and non-believers suffer. That's not what the Bible promises. It says life will happen to all of us the same, the righteous and the unrighteous, the same. But when it happens to us, we should respond differently than the rest of the world because we have a hope that they don't understand. We have a relationship that they don't understand. We have experienced redemption and forgiveness and restoration that others around the world, they don't always understand. And because of that, Paul is trying to say, hey, are you different or not? Because you should be different as a believer and a follower of Jesus. And he writes a couple of times. He writes in chapter 1 to be joyful. And then I guess they didn't get it because he said it in chapter 2, be joyful always. And then in chapter 3, he said it again. And today, this is it. There's only four chapters in Philippians. And today we're going to see it's his last chance. It's the farewell message to try to tell this church how they can have joy in the Lord. And as we walk through chapter 4 today, you're going to see four verses that you are very familiar with. This chapter is like the all-star of verses on joy. You're going to recognize immediately, oh, I've heard that. Oh, I sang that before. I memorized that before. For some of you, it was some of the very first verses that you memorized in Bible drill. Some of you just nodded because you knew, I did Bible drill, right? Others of you, you've just heard them, you've recited them, and you've claimed their truths in your life. And as we go through these, you're going to see Paul is telling us one last time, how do you have joy? And the first one we're going to look at is Philippians 4. We're going to look at verse 4. So if you have your Bibles with you, let me encourage you, because Paul is going to be telling us that the secret to having a joy-filled life is right here in these four verses. That's a pretty bold statement, I know, but he's going to say, I've told you, and I told you, and now I am summarizing it all up. I'm putting a bow on it, and I'm putting a box on it, and right here is the secret to a joy-filled life. So if you're struggling, and your joy level is not as high as it should be, pay attention today. Take notes today. Because God is going to show you how you can elevate above your circumstances, no matter what they are. Whether it's this something as easy as a leak in a bathroom, or something as difficult as standing watching a loved one struggle for their life in a hospital room, whatever it is, here's how you can have a joy-filled life. Let's look at it together, starting with verse 4. He says this, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." It says, "Rejoice in the Lord when?"
Always.
And I just lost some of you right there. Some of you went, "Psh, come on. Really? Always? I mean, not always. At least most of the time. Isn't that what it means?" No, that's not what it means. It means always. In all circumstances. Whether you understand it or not. Whether you're happy about it or not. Doesn't matter. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then he says, I'll even say it again, rejoice. This is the command that he's given us. The first thing I want you to see is that we are to rejoice in who? In the Lord. Not in you, not in what you have, not in your car, not in your possessions, not in relationships, not in money. That's not joy, because those things come and go. But you rejoice in the Lord and Him only. And Paul is saying it most emphatically, almost like he's getting a little impatient with the Philippian church. You know, when I was little and I would be driving on a road trip with my parents, me and my brother would be in the back seat. And sometimes if our cousins were with us, we would pile into the back seat, like six of us, because, you know, we didn't wear seat belts back then, so it just didn't matter. Just pile them all in, it doesn't matter, right? And we get kind of rowdy in the back seat. And what would mom say? Hey, y'all settle down back there. And we settle down for what? 10 seconds. That's about it. And we start going again, and we start poking at each other, right? And then the noise builds up again, and mom says it again. Hey, I'm serious. Y'all settle down back there. And we settle down for a minute most. And then we start going up again, and then it gets louder and louder. And then what did my mom and probably your mom do both, right? They had finally had enough, and they said, "Hey, quit it. Leave your brother alone." And I'd be like, "Yeah, but he was poking me, and I drew this line through the back seat, right?" And I would like, and I used to drive my brother crazy, because we would draw a line and say, "This is my side and this is your side." And when he wasn't looking, I would just reach over and touch his side, you know? And he would like hit me, and I would hit him back, right? And mom is, she's dealing with all this. She hears it in the back. And finally, she's had enough, and she just yells out, "Quit it!" Because I've already said it once. Don't make me say it again. Paul is frustrated with the church because in the first couple of verses of chapter 4, there's division going on and they're fighting, and he even names two of the people. You can go back and read it. He names two of the people who are leading the factions, and he's like, "You guys are focusing on all the wrong things. You got your eyes down and you're arguing and you're complaining. There's no joy in that, and we're supposed to be different so the world can see that we're different, and yet you're not different." And he said it in chapter 1. He said it in chapter 2. He said in chapter 3, and now in chapter 4, Paul goes off. He goes, "Hey, listen. Stop it. Stop what you're doing. Quit arguing and quit focusing on you. Put your eyes on God and rejoice in the Lord always." And then he said, "I shouldn't have to say it again, but I'm going to say it again. Rejoice." And when he looks at you and I going through our struggles, I wonder if God has that same idea with us. I've told you, and I told you, and I told you. Where is the joy? Why do we struggle? Why is God looking at us going, "Hey, it's enough of that. All that me stuff that you're doing, all that I want, I think stuff, all that looking down, you need to look up to God. Look up to me and follow me. You can't find joy in any of that stuff." And it feels like God gets frustrated with us sometimes. And he says, "Hey, rejoice in the Lord and the Lord only." And I mean it so much, I'm going to say it again. Rejoice in God. Where are you looking for your joy? And I have to confess, sometimes I look in the wrong place, don't you? Don't I forget sometimes, and I get my eyes down and I get distracted, and I need God to snap me back to it and go, "Hey, Matt, pay attention.
That's not where you're supposed to be. That's not what you're supposed to do. That's not what you're supposed to be thinking about or worrying about or stressing over. So what? Your roof is now on the floor. It doesn't matter, right? Somebody knows how to fix that. And it just takes a little bit of time and a little bit of money, and you don't need those things anyway. So just let someone else come in to do this for you, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. Where is your focus today? Our focus, the command is that we are to have joy in God. It is the secret to what we're supposed to be doing. The second thing he wants to tell us is the source for that joy is that we should take it to God. Not to your friend, not to your spouse, but we're supposed to take it to the Lord. Verse 6, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, y'all say everything, in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to who? To God, not to yourself, not to your buddy, not to your bestie, not to your twinsie or whoever that you go to. Don't go to them. You go to God in prayer. The source of joy comes in prayer. You go to him and you give him the petitions of your heart. You ask of things and you tell God the desires of your heart. Something amazing happens when you and I pray. I'm not talking about once in the morning prayer. I'm not talking about as you fall asleep prayer. I'm talking about you get in the presence of God and you start talking to him about the desires of your heart. Something amazing happens. If you will just stop and listen, he will change your heart. He may or may not change the circumstance, but he will always change your attitude about the circumstance. But you have to stop and listen. Psalm 46 says, be still and know that I am God. You have to not just talk at God. Here's my list of things I need you to do for me today, God. Thanks. You give him a honey-do list, and then you go on about your day. No, I'm talking about actual prayer, talking to the Lord as if he's a real person. And you have a true friendship, a true relationship, all day long, prayer. 1 Thessalonians 5 says this. It says that, be joyful always, there it is again, to another church, same thing. Be joyful always, pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you. Do you catch that? God's will for you. It's for you to be joyful always. How do you do it? What's the source of that? Praying continually. What does that look like? I'm not great at this yet. I'm trying to include God in my day all day long. A lot of times we put God on a shelf, and God, I'll get back to you tonight when work is done, or when I'm done, you know, playing golf, or when I'm done fixing a roof, or whatever it is I'm doing, I'll get back to you later, God, and we put him over there, and we go finish our day. That's not praying continually. Praying continually is you take God with you throughout your day. Wherever you go, whatever you do, God is there with you, and I'm trying to have these conversations with God as I go through the grocery store yesterday. I'm trying to talk about, man, God, when did these prices get so expensive? What are you doing with that? Could you get on that, please? Because this inflation thing is kind of difficult. But it's kind of a funny conversation, but yet it's real. I really meant it. It was not trite at all. I was really talking to God about, when did this happen? This is painful. I can't imagine how many people cannot afford cereal anymore because it doubled in. Did you know it doubled in price? I didn't know that. Obviously, I don't go buy groceries every week. But I noticed on yesterday that the groceries doubled. And I'm like, that's painful. And I'm driving back, and somebody pulled in front of me. And I said, God, did you see that person pull in front of me? Would you help them not be on their phones? Because that's going to hurt somebody. That's not really what I thought, really. But that's all I'm going to tell you that I thought. That's not what I told God, but that's, you know, that's the church version of what I told God about that person, right? I'm trying to include him in everything that I do, because prayer is the source of joy. Without prayer, guess what? Lack of joy. That you take your concerns to the Lord and you tell him about, these are the desires of my heart. And he can say, that's not right, man. You got a bad attitude. You need to fix that. And the more I talk to him about that, the more he changes my heart. Whether he fixes that situation or not, he makes me okay with that. Because that is God's will for us in Christ, is that we will be like-minded like him. That is the source. The third thing he's going to show us is the results of praying is that he will guard your heart. He's going to guard your heart. Look at verse 7. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, it will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. The peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart no matter what you face. There's the promise. No matter what you face. So when I'm standing next to Sandra and Dennis Dean, and Sandra sees her dad struggling to survive, she can have peace in her heart that passes all understanding. Why? Because God is in control, and her faith is strong, and she knows that Tom is going to go to a better place no matter what happens today. And she can put him in the hands of Almighty God. And there can be joy in spite of your circumstances. And we pray together, and there's a peace that comes over your heart that guards you. Most people would be devastated. They would walk into a room. They would see tubes everywhere, blood coming out of all of them, and people would be crushed, devastated. They would be a pile on the floor, just completely useless, just weeping, and that was not them. There would be others who would just be, I can't think straight, I don't know what to do, and their faith would crumble. I can't believe God would allow this to happen, and their faith would crumble under that. But that's not what happened, because the peace that passes all understanding will protect your heart and your mind no matter the circumstances that you face. It will guard your heart from negative thoughts and the things of this world, and you will be untouchable. You will be above all of it. And people will look at you like you are crazy. Why are you not a mess? You must be in denial. That's what they'll say. You must be in denial. You must be delusional. It's like, no, not delusional, not denial. God is in control no matter what. And that peace that passes all understanding from claiming his word and praying to him and taking your petitions before the Lord, they will guard your heart and your mind. And we watched a miracle happen this week as God sent people to pray, and nurses would pray over him in the operating room. I don't know if that's allowed. I guess it is, right? Right? Cleaning ladies to come in and sing over him while he's unconscious, singing God's mercy and God's blessing over him. Family members and churches surrounding, praying, and we watch God do amazing things in a matter of just a couple of days. And all through it all, there was that peace that passes all understanding. There was a joy in the Lord because he is the source of our strength. And he is the one that we can go to and we can trust, because his peace will guard our hearts. Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, because it is the wellspring of your life. From your heart springs forth your life. You need to guard it because it is precious. And you should not let the things of this world infiltrate your heart and your mind, because that will lead you into a bad place. Some of you may know this lady. This is Elizabeth Vargas. She is an anchor person on ABC News. She was on Good Morning America, World News Tonight, and 2020. She just recently wrote a book called Between Breaths, A Memoir of Panic and Addiction. And she talked about her struggles with negative thoughts, negative influences, which became anxiety, which became an addiction. It was so overwhelming to her that she couldn't function in her job and in her life. And the only way she could cope was to numb it with alcohol. And again, she would drink to try to numb the pain. It didn't go away, but at least it felt better for a time. And that became an addiction in her life. And if you listen to her tell the story, you can watch it on YouTube and other places. She did an interview with Guidestone and some other places, that she says that the thing that helped her the most was praying. Because when she prayed, God protected her heart from all those negative thoughts. and all those anxious moments and all those questions that she has about, well, what if this happens and what if that happens and this is beyond my control and I can't control this, and you know, and on your mind can go, and it would drive her literally crazy in the sense of, I just can't control this, and she could not function and think. And she learned that if she would go to the Lord in prayer and stop and give him those thoughts, that she could have deliverance from that. And she's saying that prayer made a difference. Not casual prayer, not an occasional prayer, not God, thank you for my meal. That's great to do. We do it in our family. That's great. I'm talking about getting before the God and pouring your heart out before him and saying, I can't control this. God, please take it from me. God, will you please? And as you talk to God in prayer, he will guard your hearts in the Lord. He will guard your mind with the power of Christ Jesus. And pray that over yourself. Pray that God would put a hedge of protection around you and your heart and your mind so that you could push out all the negative influences of the world, so that you can think straight and you can find joy. Joy that only comes from him. And verse 8, the fourth thing I want you to see is our struggle, my struggle. I would think maybe it's yours too, is that we need to think about the right things. We need to think on all the right things. Look at verse 8. It's going to give us a list of things that you and I should be focusing on in our lives. And I want you, as we go through, see how you're doing. Check the box. Do I think about this a lot? Check, check, check. You ready? Let's check the box. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think on these things. There is power in what you think about, because what you think affects where you go. You know, there's this saying, if you're a golfer and you're standing over the golf ball and you're fixing to hit the ball over water, the last thing you're supposed to do is think about the water. But you can't help it, right? You get over the golf ball and you're ready and you go, oh, please don't hit it in the water. Please don't hit it in the water. Please don't hit the water. Please don't top the ball. And I've thought about it about 10 times about what I should not do. So chances are, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to hit it right in the water. Instead, you're supposed to think about the green. The water's not even there. Ignore the water. It's not in play. You're not going to hit it there. You're hitting it on the green. But what you think about is where you go. Same is true if you're riding a horse. I'm not a great horseman, but I've heard that if you're on a horse, you should always look straight ahead, because where your eyes go is where the horse goes. And you're like, well, how is that possible? The horse can't see my eyes. How does he know where I'm looking? But what they say is, if you look to the left, then you shift to the left and you shift your weight to the left. The horse feels that and he goes to the left. Where you look is where you go. Same is true if you're driving a car. By the way, young drivers, you need to know this. If they say keep your eyes on the road, you know why? Because where you look is where the car goes. If you look over here, you're going to naturally turn the steering wheel this way, and the car is going to go that way. Where you look is where you wind up going. There is a principle that's true as well, that the things that you look at will affect what you think. What your eyes see affects what you think, and what you think determines where you go. What that means is, if you're looking at things that you shouldn't be looking at, it will adversely affect your attitude, and it'll be a joy stealer in your life. If you're looking at dark things that you shouldn't be looking at, it's going to affect you, and you're going to think about dark things, and then eventually you'll go towards and bend towards those dark things. Here's an example. I don't know if you've ever watched a scary movie late at night, just before you go to bed. But if you watch a scary movie just before you go to bed, and then you go to bed, suddenly you start thinking about scary things, right? I see some of you laughing. This must have happened last night. I don't know. Maybe y'all didn't sleep at all last night. But I have found that if I watch something scary, then I go to bed, now I'm thinking about scary things, and I hear a noise in the middle of the night, and I'll be like, what's that? And Heather's like, what are you talking about? I was like, what? Did you hear that? And she's like, go back to sleep. I didn't hear. And I've probably heard that same sound 100 times and thought nothing of it. But because I watched the scary movie, I saw it with my eyes. Now it's affecting how I think. And now my mind is just going crazy. I could be this. It could be that. I don't know what it is. Maybe we need to go check. Heather, why don't you go check? She's like, me to check? Why don't I go to check? You go check. I'm asleep, right? What you think, what you see affects how you think. And how you think affects what you do. If you were looking at sensual things, I'm going to leave it on that word right there, parents, because we have young ears in the room. If you were looking at sensual things, what you look at will affect how you think. And how you think will affect how you react to your spouse and other people. And your thoughts will determine eventually what you do. Be careful what you put before your eyes, church. Be careful because it will affect you. Paul knows that. He's saying be careful of these things because the things that you look at are going to make you think certain things, and the things that you think of is going to be determined in if you have joy or not. If you dwell on negative things, there is no joy in that. And you have to take those thoughts captive and you take them hostage and you say, that doesn't need to be in my life. I don't need to be focusing on those things, right? Go back to this verse. What did he say that we should be thinking about? Things that are true, things that are noble, things that are right and pure. That's what you we and I should be focusing on, things that are lovely and excellent and praiseworthy. That should be dominating our thoughts and our minds. That's why he says that, because that's what should be in your heart. That's joy if you think on these things. If you allow the world to permeate and you allow the world to come into your life and into your heart and into your mind with these negative things, it's going to steal your joy and you're going to be stressed and you're going to be anxious and you're going to be under condemnation and you're always going to be focusing on you. And that is not the focus of a follower of Jesus. Do you see that? You see what Paul's trying to say? He's trying to warn us at the very end of this book that this is really where really joy comes from. Focus on these things. And I have to tell you that this verse right here and the focus on these positive things is why Halloween is my least favorite holiday of all of them, because I don't see that in Halloween. I see it in Christmas, absolutely. Pure, holy, that's great. I see it in Easter, absolutely. I see it in Thanksgiving, sure, thankful for what God has given, but I don't see it in that holiday. And it's been my least favorite holiday forever. And that's why for our family, we just have never celebrated that. That's just been our conviction. That's not saying that anybody else shouldn't. I'm just saying that's our conviction because of this verse, I don't see anything pure and holy and honorable and admirable in those things. I remember in Florida, we went to a city park and we walked in and it was a Halloween festival. All Hallows Eve is what it said on the banner. And I said, oh, didn't know this was going on. I said, just step in and see what this is all about. And as we walked in, it said All Hallows Eve celebration sponsored by the Witches Coven of Blank County. And we stopped and said, are you kidding me? This is on the banner? This is what this is? And we looked over, and sure enough, there was some fortune telling going over here, and there were some other things over there. And we said, this is not for us. And we turned around and walked back away. Be careful when the world tries to push dark things upon you. Because if you will accept them into your life, then it will take you there with your thoughts. Because what you see is what you think. And the things that you think is going to have a tendency to push you where you're going to go. It matters what you're thinking about. It matters what you're looking at. Because it's going to steal your joy and it's going to take you to a place that you never thought that you wanted to go. Whatever is pure, whatever is holy, and honorable, and admirable, and praiseworthy, and excellent, think on these things. There's a principle called the principle of dominion. And dominion means you're giving something the right to be there. Like I have dominion in my house. If you came over and you said, Matt, you can't come in your house, I say, I can too. I live here, right? I'm paying for this house. This is my property. I have the right to be here. I have dominion here. And then I would turn around and say, but you don't, so you don't have to stay. That's okay. You decide. Listen to me. You decide what has dominion in your heart and in your mind. You decide. The world cannot push it upon you, and you decide what has the right to be there. And when you look at things that you shouldn't look at, you're letting those things be a part of your life. You're giving it the right to be there. It sets up dominion in your heart and in your mind. It did not force itself on you. It did tempt you, but you decided when you asked it to come in, you gave it dominion and the right to be there. And once you do that, friends, it is hard to get it out because you said yes to whatever it is that temptation is. Whether it's sensual or it's dark in nature or whatever it is, whatever you decide, I'm going to let that be a part of my life. You give it a right to be there. Or maybe you do the opposite. Maybe you decide, I want to give dominion to whatever is pure and honorable and holy and praiseworthy. And I don't want to watch things that are not like that. I want to keep my focus on that. And if you will do that, you have a better chance of finding joy than you ever imagined possible. What's your joy level like today? What are you giving dominion in your life? I had a friend tell me one time, she said, my marriage is falling apart and my family is going through struggle and it's not me, it's them. They're bringing these things into our family and into our life. And here's how she described it, and this broke my heart. Maybe it will yours too. She said this. She said, the devil is dancing in my living room and I can't do anything about it. Because they have brought that into our marriage and into our family. They gave dominion to something, a negative influence that was affecting how they think and now affecting what they do. And that will steal your joy. What has dominion in your life today? Is it whatever is pure and holy and honorable? Praiseworthy and excellent, is that what's in your heart? Is that what your mind is filled with? Or are you constantly thinking about the negative things? Things that make you anxious and afraid are not from God. Things that make you fearful, it's not from God. Things that are self-condemning, He's not the God of condemnation. He's the God of love and forgiveness and restoration. If you'll just repent and accept Him into your heart, He will set you free. He is a God of freedom. Not of bondage. How is your joy today? What is keeping you from being joyful? And are you allowing it? Are you choosing for that to be what you think and what you feel and how you live? Will you just bow your heads where you are? And I want you to listen to the words of this hymn. And you and I have sung it 1,000 times. Maybe not 1,000, hundreds of times you've sung it. But I don't want you to miss the words to this hymn because it speaks so true to how to have true joy. And it says this, O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior. It's life more abundant and free. Is that what you want? You want abundant life? You want freedom from the bondage that you face? Then this chorus, listen to this chorus. It talks about freedom. It says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and His grace. If you're looking to yourself and you're looking to the world, there is no joy there. Look to God, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let Him set you free from the things that bind you, from the things that haunt you, from those voices in your head to the voices of criticism from friends and family that only seek to condemn you and they make you feel like less of a person. You need to be set free from that. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and His grace. Father God, we come to you because you alone are the one who can save, and you alone are the ones who can heal, and we need that in our lives. God, we feel, Lord, the pressure of the world around us, and it seems like it overtakes us sometimes, God, and I pray that we would recognize that it's our choices, that we're giving it dominion in our hearts and our lives, and I pray that right now that somebody would say, enough, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm not going to listen to that anymore. And that somebody would say, no. And they would put up a boundary there and say, I am not that. Those are lies. That criticism is not true. And I pray, Lord, that as they take it to you, that you would take that from them, that you would guard their hearts and their minds, and the peace of God that passes all understanding would wash over them, even in this moment. As we cry out to you, God, take it from us. Give us freedom from it. Restore us. Give us that peace that passes all understanding, Father. In these next few minutes, Father, I pray that someone would turn their life over to you. They would give their heart to Jesus, either for the first time, or they would renew that commitment once again to say, I want to be a follower of Jesus. I want to be about God's work. I want to have my eyes on him and him alone. And I pray, Lord, that somebody would give their hearts to you today, Jesus, and that you would come in and clean them up from the inside and take away all the negative and the doubt and give back joy. Incredible, consuming joy of the Lord. God, in these next few moments, you do a work in our life. We're going to sing praises to you about your faithfulness and how no matter what we walk through today, Lord, that you will go with us. And it doesn't matter what the trial is. It doesn't matter how little it is or how big it is or how devastating it is, that you will walk with us through that fire and that you will bring us out safe on the other side. We trust you, Jesus, and we celebrate who you are today. We pray it in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. This is an invitation for you to respond to God. There's an altar here for you to kneel at. There'll be staff to pray with you, or maybe you just celebrate your great God and how he helps you through whatever fire you find yourself in today. You do not walk alone. Let's stand together and let's sing and celebrate our great God.
Healing every heart.
worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, bending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, we sing now. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, sing it out now. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God.
No matter what you face today, He will make a way. And that is where true joy comes from. And when you pray and ask and God answers, make sure you stop and praise His name for what He has done. Don't move on to the next request. Rejoice, church, because He has forgiven, and rejoice because He's answered, and rejoice because He has restored. And as you leave today, rejoice in the Lord, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. Thanks for worshiping with us today. If you're a guest with us, I hope that you'll stop by the welcome table on the way out. Let us get to know you a little bit better. Step across the aisle and greet some people on your way out. God bless you. Have a great week in the Lord.